everybody. Welcome to the Swing Museum. I'm your host, Jan Eberle, and tonight we're bringing you the interview with Glenn Miller Orchestra leader, Nick Hilscher. It's a fantastic interview. It's filled with emotion, laughs, and a lot of information. You'll get to know Nick and the band a little bit more than you did. You're going to have an opportunity not only to see this interview, but to see some fantastic music played, not only by Nick and the band, but by the original members, as well as singer Ray Eberle. So I hope you enjoy, and I'll check back with you in a little while.
Thank you. I see it. Recording.
Hey.
No.
Well, I can't, huh? I can't tell you how good it is to see you after all this time. I was certainly hoping that I would have seen you in Clorinda. However, we know that Clorinda is not going to be this year. But I wanted to take an opportunity to share your history as a singer, as a band leader, as a lover of all Miller, as we both are, with an audience, especially the treat that we have to go video, which is going to make it great because they don't just have to listen to your recordings. Now they get to actually watch them during this show. So it's going to be great.
Well,
so one thing I wanted to start with, I know that you and I have had conversations in the past, and you made it no secret that your childhood is really the secret key that unlocks all of your love for the Glenn Miller Orchestra, having witnessed the Glenn Miller story, having really been taken with Jimmy Stewart, and in the whole era in the music, and even sharing it with your parents and turning them on to it. So you have this this piece of you that almost could have been from another era. How do you feel growing up with this has really driven you to the point that you were facing the possibility of becoming the new Glenn Miller vocalist? How do you think that evolved?
Well, that's interesting. Well, firstly, thank you, Jan, for having me on. And it is a pleasure. It's great to talk with you, and it's great to see you in this context. And I do miss seeing you, though, in Clorinda, which is about where we'd be around about right now. So thank you very much. I think, for me, some people naturally have an inclination toward one thing or the other, and I think that starts to show in many people's lives pretty early. I can see it in my own kids. As far as with me, I had this desire for music and performing music and kind of, I guess you could say, the entertainment industry, where I used to, when I was 4 years old, I would dress up as best I could as 1970s Elvis Presley, put on the live LP of, you know, some live recording of Elvis, and I would stand on the hearth and do concerts with a guitar for my parents and my grandparents and that kind of thing. So there was sort of a natural desire to perform. And it just seems like that Glenn Miller, my story of getting to the Glenn Miller sound, Glenn Miller and his orchestra, Jimmy Stewart, that just sort of, it progressed from, you know, my early days of Elvis Presley and the Oak Ridge Boys, Ray Charles and Buddy Holly, which a lot of that stuff is actually, although it's country, it's swing music. It's based on a swing feel. And I think I just naturally loved that stuff. So then I saw It's a Wonderful Life and I thought, man, this is a great culture. This is my grandfather's culture. And so it just sort of began right there. And that was my introduction when I saw the Glenn Miller story, my introduction to Glenn Miller's music. And then I bought this cassette tape called A Legendary Performer, which I think was released, the original LP was released in 1974. So I had the cassette of it, and it was this really long, I think it was on two LPs maybe, really long album of all these. It's a compilation of air checks, radio broadcasts of Glenn Miller and his orchestra. So that's the sound that's in my mind, firstly, when I think of Glenn Miller and his orchestra, was these crowds going crazy, like it was, you know, Billy Joel at the ballpark or you know, that kind of thing. And then I got into the studio recordings, but my passion has always been sort of those air checks and that kind of thing. But that was the progression as far as finding this new love of music, not just Elvis, but now Glenn Miller, and then the big band era, Tommy Dorsey, Harry James, et cetera, you know, the whole list. And it began to progress. As a performer, I did start taking piano lessons when I was 8 years old. And that was a major, you know, that was my musical instrument as far as taking lessons, doing something as far as that. But I was a singer naturally, never took vocal lessons. I just sang in the church choir from young musicians on up, you know, as it went on. And then I would sing in my bedroom. And so when I got into Miller, naturally, I was getting into your dad, Ray Eberly, and I was getting into Frank Sinatra. I was getting into Bing Crosby, and et cetera, et cetera. And was honing my craft in my bedroom in front of my mirror. And that's where it all really started to develop and really take shape, as in this could be a career. And I was always praying, this is what I would love to do if I be blessed to be able to do it. So I decided to go to college, and whereas I was thinking at first, I'll just major in business and I can use that in the music industry. My piano professor or teacher from high school decided otherwise and said, you're making a mistake, you need to go to college. And so I wound up going to Samford University as a classical pianist and earned a Bachelor of Music degree at Samford. However, I took a year off between my junior year and my senior year in order to join the Glenn Miller Orchestra. I had recorded a demo tape of my singing the summer before my junior year. And so I had that cassette, and during my fall semester, which is the semester I did my junior recital, I sent that tape to Larry O'Brien, and he liked it. He gave it to Julia Rich, who was the female vocalist and the road manager at the time. And she called me up the day after my junior recital in November. And she said, basically, we want you to audition with us live. And I wound up doing that in February. It was Super Bowl Sunday of 1998. So
No competition there.
That's right. No competition there. It was hilarious.
We'd love to play another one for you. Of course, all of us in the room are missing getting to see Ed and Judy Polish this evening. Ed is certainly on our minds. He's in our hearts and our prayers and our thoughts. Ed is a remarkable man with a remarkable mind. And he's been really great at just sending me information that I need and the like. And Ed has given me a list of tunes that were never recorded by the band, of course, in the studio for RCA Victor Bluebird Records. But he's also given me a list of these same tunes that were never recorded by the band at all. There's no air check of them. There's nothing. So I kind of wonder what in the world these tunes sound like. So I chose one of them, and we're going to do it for you right now. It's a great Jerry Gray arrangement that he wrote for the band in about 1940 on a tune called Alabama Bound.
My dad's side of the family is from Georgia, both Georgia, where I now reside, but and also his father's side was from Wisconsin. So I've been a Packers fan all my life. Right. And the Packers were in the Super Bowl that night. And so this was a major thing for me to miss that, to audition with the Glenn Miller Orchestra. But the band played in Macon, Georgia.
Okay.
And there might have been 50 people in the audience because it was Super Bowl Sunday. And I've sat in my seat during the show. This was after I had auditioned during the sound check and looked around and thought, I hope it's because it's Super Bowl Sunday. So
they heard I was here.
Right, I know. I auditioned that during the sound check. And I came in, I didn't know what I was going to sing. Nothing. It was just, I came in with this passion and knowledge of the music, and I knew how to sing it. And he said, let's sing Serenade in Blue, Chicago, and Chattanooga Choo Choo. And thankfully, I knew him, and I said, let's do it. So I sang, and then Julia hired me that right after the soundtrack, and said, you want the gig? And shook out her hand, or stuck out her hand for me to shake. And I knew that when I did that, when I took her hand, that I was quitting school and going to go on the road. So,
yeah. And I think you were probably a little bit older than my father was when he did audition for Miller, and he did get the job. He was 18 when he auditioned, and then he turned 19, and he had to go back up to upstate to confront the father, and he was afraid because my uncle was already, you know, in the business, and he already had to say goodbye. So what did your parents say when you told them what was happening?
Well, I think maybe the way that your grandparents might have said in the long run, this is really not bad. My dad was the driving force of my, I guess you could say, me pursuing the music business. Me doing this. He's the one who said, all right, so you finished your sophomore year, but now you're at home for the summer, you ought to do something, and how about this, let's record a demo tape. And so it was his influence, and he's the one who financially made it happen. And then you should send this to various places, you should send it to the Glenn Miller Orchestra. And so when I got the job, I mean, they're the ones who drove me to the audition. They've been supportive all my life. I think when I was in high school and really thinking, I want to go into this, and I was transcribing Dixieland tunes and putting together bands in my parents' house to play this Dixieland music, my mom was saying, boy, what is he going to do if he becomes a musician? My dad was saying, who knows? You might go further than what we think. So, let's push them towards this. And so, they've always been an encouragement.
It's great when you have support. Sometimes we change direction just because we feel that it's right, and we may feel that it's right. Somebody else doesn't know. They go, oh, what? You know. So it's really nice to have. I had support of my father as well when I told him when I was 16 I really wanted to become a singer. So he was as was his father.
And we'd like to follow that one up with one that Ray Everly recorded with the band. And this one turned out to be a number one hit for Glenn Miller's orchestra. A beautiful piece by Meredith Wilson. And I see Jan and Ray out here in the audience, so I'd like to dedicate it to you, Jan, and you, Ray. This is a beautiful piece. You and I.
Vocalist with the orchestra?
So I auditioned when I was 20. So yes, Ray was 2 years younger than I was, but and then by the time, so I auditioned in February and then joined in the summer, August the 1st of 1998. And I had just turned 21, May 27th. And so I stayed on with the band for 1 year, 98 to 99, summer of 98 through the Japan tour that they did in late spring, early summer of that year, and then I left. And then I finished up my senior year of college while I still had piano jobs, and then was asked to come back. And I knew what the lifestyle was, living in hotels, moving from town to town. And so part of me didn't want to go back. And yet I love the music, I love performing, and so it was sort of an iffy thing at the moment. And Julia Rich convinced me to come out and sub on piano for just 1 month. That's all you have to do. We just want you for 1 month to sub on the piano chair.
Really?
They needed a piano sub, and Brian Anthony, another vocalist, he was singing in that chair at that time anyway. So she convinced me to come out, and so I knew what Larry liked as far as a pianist. Make sure you get the solos down, and the rest of the time just kind of hang out by the piano chair. And so that's what I did. And I did my gig the way that he liked for it to be done. But every night I would hear Brian sing and I would think, you know, when he leaves, I think I would like to go back over there. And then you're also getting paid. And I didn't want to just leave a paying job. So when Brian left, Larry was perfectly fine with me going back to the vocal chair, which I did. And I wound up in that spot for another 4.5 years. And when I took that job, I also became the sound man for the band and ran sound. You know, back then we were doing a lot of 4-hour dances, and you'd come into these places that didn't have sound systems. You needed a sound system, and we had one under the bus. And so I became pretty good at doing that as well. So it was a wonderful job. I loved it and stayed with it for 4.5 years until I knew, okay, the girl that I started dating my senior year, she needs an answer. What am I doing here? I need to propose. So I did propose, and then I got off the road Valentine's Day of 2005, and we were married the next month.
Ooh, good move. Smooth. Yes. Sure. Very good. did go by. I mean, you and Sarah were together. You knew each other well. You both, you know, had your loves and things that you wanted, things that you aspired to. So when did the opportunity to lead the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra come along?
Right. So we were married in March of 05, and I had a bright idea that we should move to Nashville. I'd looked at moving to New York City, actually, and there was a person there who had produced a Sinatra show that was an off-Broadway musical. And he wanted me to come out, but it had just gone off Broadway. And so I really was scared. I guess I was scared to move. I mean, moving to New York with, you know, not a lot and not knowing what to do, not going into something, just moving. So I had the idea, well, let's move to Nashville. Maybe I can do something there. And it wound up that we just lived in Nashville, and I wound up being called by Carol Morrow, I think sometime in summer of 2005, to come with the band on a cruise that was celebrating Tommy Dorsey's 100th birthday. So that cruise was coming up in November of that year. And along with that, I got a call from someone who, well, actually the gentleman who wanted me to do that Sinatra show in New York called me and said, the Juilliard Jazz Orchestra is doing a 100th birthday celebration of Tommy Dorsey for a week at Lincoln Center, Dizzy's Club, Coca-Cola. And they're looking for a vocalist, and I think that you should send him your stuff. Now, my stuff was an album that I had recorded in 2002 with the Glenn Miller Orchestra. So I just sent that album to that person, and they called me and said, we want you to come and be our vocalist for this. So I came, and we did a quick rehearsal, and the next night did about a week's worth of Dorsey shows with the Juilliard Jazz Orchestra. And then I went home, and Sarah and I got on a cruise ship with Buddy Morrow and the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. And that began my relationship with Buddy and with that band, and wound up singing with them from November of 2005, whenever I could make the date, because they were not getting on the bus and doing long stints. It was more getting on the bus and maybe doing 2 weeks or 10 days, something like that. But they did have a number of cruises that were lined up. And so whatever I could do, you know, as far as when they would call to ask me to work, I would take the gig. And that relationship continued up till Buddy's passing in 2010.
Right.
And when Buddy passed away, just shortly before that, I was down in Orlando where they lived, in the Orlando area, to do a job with the Orlando Jazz Orchestra. And so they wanted me to meet while I was down there, and Buddy and Carol expressed that they wanted Buddy to hang it up. He was only a 91. And so they wanted him to step back, and they asked me to start doing the gigs. They only had two more gigs on the books at that time anyway. And so I did those two performances. Buddy led one of them, and then I led the second one. And mm-hmm. And I think it was the next day Buddy passed away.
Thank you.
If you're just joining us, you are listening and watching Share a Vision Radio and Television. And this is the Swing Museum, Thursday evening, 7 p.m., and we're right in the middle of a fantastic interview, along with music, with Nick Hilscher, the leader of the Glenn Miller Band. Let's continue on with the show.
Did you ever think, or did you ever expect that you might want that opportunity to come along to lead an orchestra, or were you really firmly, you know, entrenched in being a vocalist? Did it really ever occur to you before it was offered to you?
I think that I want this to be taken properly. I think when I was in high school, I knew I wanted my own band. And when I joined the Glenn Miller Orchestra, there was something that I kind of knew this could be a gig that I love, and I'd love to be in Larry O'Brien's shoes when he retires. So then, you know, going back to that time period when I was singing with the band, I think it was in 2003 or 2004, right before I left, we were in Japan and I was eating breakfast with Larry one morning and Julia Rich. And Larry, who was, sometimes you had to pull things out of him. This was not pulled out of him at all. He just was having a little bit of conversation at breakfast, and he stopped and said, "You know, Nick, I'm not going to do this forever, and I think that you should think about taking over this job when I retire, putting in your name." Well, he wound up doing it for another 6 years, but
he was right. That wasn't forever.
That's right. I guess with Larry's incredible run as the music director, another 6 years was nothing. So,
exactly.
So you know, and he's as healthy as can be still. But anyway, going back to the Dorsey Band, yes, when that opportunity came up as far as that gig, which I really was not thinking about, honestly, it was more my own band still at the time. When I was not doing Dorsey dates, I was trying to do my own dates. And Phoenix Talent Agency had put a little run for me to do at Christmas concerts. So things were kind of slowly, you know, beginning for me as far as that goes. And then they asked me to be the leader of the Dorsey Band. So I did that in 2011, but we didn't have a lot of dates on the books, but it was really an enjoyable thing leading that band.
I can imagine that opportunity was almost like a little gift, sort of a hidden gift to prepare you for walking out and standing in front of 17 guys, you know. And I think even without that, I think it would have still been a natural, because you just felt everything that you were doing with the music as a singer, as a piano player, certainly. I mean, it just from that alone and bringing yourself up with that. I think we've all benefited greatly by you jumping into, thankfully, into that spot.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on the tenor saxophone, Carl Schultz. Alex Pila back there on the trumpet. How about it for George Reinert on trombone?
So the Miller Band has been around since, you know, before 38, but the successful band that kicked off at the Ray Moore Ballroom in March of 1938 was the band that kept going until today. So, you know, what changes do you think may have evolved, especially, you know, maybe since, say, for instance, Larry?
Sure.
What changes do you see in the orchestra that would have evolved that you've witnessed?
Right. Well, I think as far as changes, you almost have to go back to maybe 1956. In a way, Ray McKinley came in, and in my opinion, there are a lot of recordings of that band with Ray McKinley from 1956 to 66. And really fine recordings, early stereo stuff and whatnot. But you kind of find that McKinley, and I think he had the freedom to do this in the 50s and 60s, the music was developing, the bands were changing, and he went right along with it. He was still doing the big hits, of course, but he's also doing Hallelujah, I Love Her So, and tunes are being written for the orchestra like... I think Whistle Stop was one that's kind of based on Tuxedo Junction, but has a little more of a, I don't want to say bebop, but you know, there's a little more jazz influence in a way too with some of that stuff. And I listened to the McKinley recordings of the hits and I love them for what they are, but it's not the sound of, in my opinion, it's not the sound of that day. Anyway, the music progressed, you know, with Buddy DeFranco and mm-hmm. on and on, Peanut Sucko. Everybody had their own idea, Jimi Henderson. I think one thing that Larry did was kind of bring it back to original Miller. And Larry had he was bringing out arrangements that Ray Everly was singing that probably had not been sung since Ray did them. And so as a vocalist who, I love those arrangements. And even though they're pitched about a whole step higher than I want to sing it in the Tommy Dorsey Sinatra key, right? But for some reason, Ray was made to sing maybe even, you know, just a notch higher on some of these things. But I think that has even made me a better singer. You know, it stretched me. And I love the fact that Larry would come to me and say, "You ever heard Starlit Hour?" And I would say, "No." And so I'd listen to a recording, I'd learn it. And, "You ever heard A Handful of Stars?" "No." And so he would pull out this stuff. And so I think that is a great thing that Larry did with this orchestra.
Those are two awesome vocals.
Oh, they're awesome.
I love the songs.
I completely agree with you. And a lot of them, I honestly didn't know when I had joined the band. I loved Miller. And when I came out, you know, Julia Rich will say, I didn't have to tell Nick anything. He sort of became the leader of the vocal group just by the way that he sang. You know, I wasn't having to tell him pitches and know the lyrics or this. He knew them, but I still was learning a lot just from simply what Larry was pulling out. Now, Larry would also do other things. You know, we were playing a lot of dances, like I said. So there were things that were not Miller. And he had these beautiful ballads on these hits from the 60s and, I love that stuff, you know, but kind of rock ballads in a way. Gorgeous sound from Larry, but he also was a traditionalist in a sense of starting to really delve into that book. And he had a long time to do it over the decades, you know, that he was the leader. So when I became the music director of the band, what I wanted to do was to take what I knew under Larry. And I think that, honestly, maybe this is not always the case, but I think when you have a good and strong foundation already, if you're a leader coming in and taking over the job of the previous person, and all of a sudden it's going to be, I'm the leader, I'm the boss, you have to do what I say, and you're going to change everything, it's not a good way to go. So what I did was I took what Larry had laid as a foundation and thought, okay, now I get to do as well, you know, what I want to do. I can take the tempos I want to take now. I can change these articulations. And the guys in the band they rolled with every punch. Everything I have thrown at them, there's never are you sure you want to do that? They really go with what I ask them to do. Took the job as the music director January 12th of 2012. And so my first Clarinda was in the summer, and I wanted to present a few new things that Larry had not done. So pulled a couple of things out of the library, and I think So You're the One might have been one, the Modern Era's first, not a recording, but one of the first things that the Modern Era's did in 1940.
I'm not even entirely sure. I know that song.
Oh, and yeah, So You're the One. And I'm trying to think of who the composer is, but it's a Jerry Gray arrangement, and it just featured the four guys. So, like Make Believe Ballroom. And so, you know, we did that, and I remember some of the big fans of the band who I had known from previous years of playing Clarinda. They really were impressed with the orchestra, the way that it sounded, and the excitement of it. And everything I think that I was wanting to accomplish up to that point, I felt, wow, this is great. It seems like the Miller fans may like what's happening here. Mm-hmm. But then I thought, well, let's just push the limit and have been delving in more and more. And so maybe the next year, instead of maybe a couple of new things, it was the hits plus new stuff as you know, much as possible, that kind of stuff. So
I remember probably one of the last, I guess, few years that I'd seen Larry out there. He brought some Ray Eberly vocals out, and I thought I knew most all of them at that point. Not only had I been a collector, and then I'd done radio, and then I was obviously singing and doing some of those. I enjoyed watching him when he introduced them, because he got this smile on his face, and Larry didn't smile too much except to the audience on stage. He was just very, right. very focused, you know. Yep. There were a few things that I recall going, wow, this is really neat. And I approached him one time. This was reasonably early on, and I didn't know all that much about Larry. And I didn't know how much he actually had worked with my father. And he said, I loved working with your father because he was so easy to get along with. And he would really take chances and when opportunity allowed. And he said he taught me a lot about doing the same thing as I, you know, went on. So I don't know exactly what respect that was, whether it was small group or my father's orchestra itself. But just knowing that about Larry is very endearing, because I do think that he really brought back a part of it to me was the crisp suit. I don't mean literally. I mean there was a dedication that came with the early Miller band that went through Glenn's time that was very, you know, you were just, it wasn't as there's, I've noticed since you've taken the helm that there are really great opportunities for some of these sidemen to do some great solos, and they come in at a spot and they do something that you allow, and I think even subconsciously, because you know it'll work so well, and they love that. The look on their face is amazing. So anyway, I really do, you know, see the evolution in my mind. Whoever is holding the baton is the leader of the band, is in charge, is the one. And it happens until you pass the baton on to the next one, that next brick. So I'm really so pleased that things went so well for you. Not every moment is without its challenges, I'm quite sure.
Of course.
But I think we're all really thrilled that this evolved. It's a storybook thing. It's something maybe you might write about one day.
Maybe.
I yearn for you so much again. star, my haven in heaven above. You are everything I
Now I want to move forward a little bit in time to early March. Can you tell me a little bit, share a little bit with us how Charles DiStefano approached you in regards to having to probably put a halt to all of the performances for this year in lieu of the coronavirus?
You know, I was keeping up, just going back to the hotel after a show and just watching the news and being aware kind of what was going on. So before Charles called me, Clorinda called me. It was Sherry Greenwood, and she said, hey, I just want to let you know, we're really contemplating this and what to do. And I think that was my first thought of, oh, this is going to affect us in a major way. Maybe, we'll see. And I think that Clorinda, I want to say that they had already, you know, before they made the announcement, of course, but they had already decided we better not try this year. And then that's when, soon after that, that it kind of started to filter down to Charles calling me and saying, you know, if you are, I know you like to go out and sign CDs, but if you're concerned about meeting people, you don't have to feel obligated to go out and sign CDs. And you know, and I think that message was also told to our sales team. Mm-hmm. If you're not comfortable going out and selling merchandise after a show, this is big enough that you need to do what's right, for what you think is right. Now, me though, I mean, I love going out and meeting people. And I think it took about maybe a week or two before there were conscientious decisions once in a while where I would say, I'm not going out. Something's brewing. Well, then we played a concert in UCLA on March the 13th. And the promoter actually came on stage and said, we're doing tonight's show, but we think that our Bakersfield show is probably not going to happen. And I think already by that point, things were happening in California as far as they were starting to tighten up the reins. And so I can't remember if we had a gig that was scheduled on the 12th, but I know I was in the hotel all day on the 12th. And then the 13th, that show was indeed canceled and made certain made official that morning, and we drove to Bakersfield anyway. And then that night we found out that every show from March the 14th up to our break for Easter was canceled. Just in one fell swoop, boom. And so we got on the bus the next morning. I had to pack that night. And in packing, I don't keep a lot of stuff at home as far as clothing. It's sort of it could be cold at home still. I need to pack this. I need to pack that. I wonder how long I'm going to be away. And so I had the wherewithal to throw, I'll throw a couple of suits in just in case and this and that. And then flew home on the 14th from Las Vegas and have been home ever since. And I think 2 weeks after I had been home, Charles called me and said, now the cancellations are up to Memorial Day. Mm-hmm. And 2 weeks after that, he called me and said, the cancellations are now up through mid-July. And still now on June the 3rd? Okay. We have a few dates on the books in August, but I'm not sure where that's going to go. So
it's unpredictable. The thing about this is that there's so much overwhelming unknown about it. The only thing that we can do is be cautious, and patient and try to understand that not everyone is going to really know. I know that in my personal feeling is that a lot of what's going on right now that's very uncomfortable in the country, I think has a lot to do with people haven't coped with it. It's very difficult to cope with. You're coping with the possibility of getting seriously ill, of losing your job. So it is a very unsure time. However, we have ways like we have today of making things happen. And I think what I'd like to do before I go on to close out the show is, I'll be playing music from the orchestra all during the show. And so what's going to happen here is I would like to know if you would like to debut on our show. Actually, it's out on YouTube, but it'll be out on our show. It'll be shown worldwide. Your new virtual recording of In the Mood.
Yes, that'd be great. So we decided that as we were seeing other groups doing this type of thing, within just maybe a week of being home, it sort of became a goal for Glenn Miller Productions, for all of us that are involved. We should try to put together something. Mm-hmm. So we did put together, our vocal group started out by doing an a cappella version of Perfidia. And then we did In the Mood.
Okay. What happened to the Perfidia?
We made it. We started a fan club, and so we made that Perfidia video available for the fan club. But we thought we want to make sure that everybody gets to see the big one, and of course that being In the Mood. And there's a lot of time and effort that gets put into this, not just the individual musicians at their homes having to, listen to a recording and play on top of that recording, but then having all of those files sent to someone to be able to put this together. And our female vocalist, Hannah Truckenbro, did a marvelous job of putting the video together. Mm-hmm. And our pianist, Daniel Thompson, he did a marvelous job of syncing all the music together. So he did the audio and Hannah did the video. And I think turned out really, really well. Splendid job.
Isn't it just amazing that a year ago you wouldn't have really thought about doing those things? I mean, we talk about music videos, but not like this, not like it being your new existence for a while, And I remember when Jimmy Fallon came on and started to broadcast The Tonight Show, and I called Ray and I said, Ray, Jimmy Fallon's in his house, just like I am right now and like yes, you yes. are. And here we are doing this. And I'm thinking to myself, it's a bad idea. Let's get this Zoom thing. Let's try to do this. And then of course, the orchestra I worked for, the Pops Orchestra, this had the same sort of just all of a sudden, bam, hitting the wall thing. And we had to cancel our last performance for the season as well. So, and right now we're presuming that we're going to probably be having to do a lot of outside venues we're going to see how that's going to work out. So it's thinking outside the box. These are unknown and strange times, but there's opportunity and gifts everywhere.
Right. I think you're right.
Yeah. Thank you so much for spending the time with me. And I can't wait to watch the video here at the end. And we're going to be airing this on June 11th at 7 p.m. East and West. So tell everybody in the band and tell everyone. I'm asking for them, Sarah and the girls, and that I miss everybody and your folks.
Well, Jan, it's always a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
I have had an unbelievably wonderful time this evening, and I hope you have as well. It's been one of the best interviews I could ever imagine doing with a great, great friend like Nick, and I'm glad that you could join us. I'd like to take the opportunity to throw this back to Nick so that he can sign off for us in a very special way. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time. So long, everybody.
Hey everyone, this is Nick Hilscher with the Glenn Miller Orchestra. And you know, I get a lot of requests, but probably the most requested song that we perform, and we do so every night, is In the Mood. It was a huge hit in 1939 for Glenn Miller and his orchestra, and it's one of my favorites that we perform every single day. Now, of course, the band is not performing right now as we're all on quarantine and each of the members are scattered throughout the United States. But we thought that we would put this video together. And we hope that you like it. Here's In the Mood.
One, two, three, four.